Hello everyone. Today we're going to talk about how to assemble a mitochondrial genome with next-generation sequence data. This is kind of a follow-up project from my master thesis. In my master project, I looked at the stonefly Deinocast cephalotis and its population structure in the Sauerland region. Basically, I sequenced CO1, the barcoding gene, and also I developed new microsatellite markers from 454 sequencing data. And with this 454 data, we also now going to assemble the mitochondrial genome for Deinocast cephalotis. I do this together with a bachelor student, and here is how it works. The starting point of the project is the 444 data. So if you look into a cell, you have your nuclear genes in the core, and then around in the cytoplasm, you have a lot of mitochondria. And those mitochondria also have a small genome. And for sequencing, you extract your DNA out of your cell, and then you're going to fragment your DNA into small pieces, and you make a selection for a certain size range and put those pieces onto the sequencer. The main goal of the sequencing was to obtain some microsatellite sequences for marker development. We didn't sequence the genome in very deep coverage, but as we have a lot of mitochondria in the cell, the mitochondrial sequence fragments will be overrepresented compared to the nuclear genes. So for most nuclear genes, you will only find one copy, but we can expect a higher coverage in the mitochondrial sequences. The first challenge, of course, is to find your mitochondrial sequences, because they're mixed also with the core genome. So around 200 sequences of our 90,000 reads are probably mitochondrial reads that we need to filter out. Luckily for us, there's already a mitochondrial genome published for another stonefly, Pteronarchis princeps, and it's from North America. So basically, it's kind of distanced from the stonefly we found here in Germany. You could say around the sequence differences is to 80 to 70% across the whole genome, but there's still enough to filter out our fragments. To find out which of these 90,000 fragments belong to the mitochondrial genome of Deinocast, we took the Pteronarchis genome that is already complete and used it as a reference. So with a program called BLAST, we compared every fragment in our database from the sequence data, compared it to the genome, and basically wrote everyone that fits into a table. Then I have written an R script that will filter all the reads out of the sequencing data and will give me a faster file with the quality scores. And those you can put into Genius to assemble your genome with the help of the reference genome. What you see on top is the reference genome of Pteronarchis, and down below the blue lines, those are the actual sequences with quality scores. As lighter the blue, as better is the sequence quality. As you can see initially, there are some gaps. By sorting out all the errors in the alignment, we can then create the first dwarfed genome of Deinocast cephalotis. The dwarfed mitochondrial genome for Deinocast is the consensus you see on top, and we export this one and blast it again against the database. This time we hope that we find some more reads, because the Deinocast dwarfed genome is much more similar to the actual reads than the Pteronarchis genome. We are able to increase the coverage by around 10%. Now it's time to go over the whole genome again and look at regions that have low coverage or some problems with the sequences. As all reads in the 444 sequencing are obtained at random, you will get just by chance some areas which have high coverage and some which have a lower coverage. Those gaps of uncertainty need to be resequenced with Sanger sequencing. So you basically develop some primers and put them on the sides of the region you want to sequence, and you sequence the region again. This is what we're going to do the next 2 weeks. We will order the primers next week, and I keep you updated with the project. To recap, we got the initial coverage of the mitochondrial genome by 444 sequencing, which we used to develop microsatellite markers, and we picked out the interesting reads from our 444 data by comparing our reads to a Pteronarchis reference genome. After the first assembly and finding of some additional reads from our database, we're now going to close the remaining gaps of low coverage with Sanger sequencing, and then we're going to go to the fun part, which is analyzing the whole genome. So in the next few months, we will end up with the complete genome of Deinocast cephalotis, and the cool thing is we can now compare our genome to the previously published Pteronarchis reference genome that we used also for assembling our mitochondrial genome, and we can see what interesting differences we might find between those two species. We then can do some phylogenetic analysis, and this can tell us something about the history of this organism in comparison to other species. So if you have any questions about the project or the methods we used, feel free to leave us a comment below. I'll keep you updated. Until next time, bye bye.